ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, I want now to introduce one colleague of mine from the University of Vienna, Medical University of Vienna. It is Professor Dr. Dagmar Eigner. She studied psychology, physiology, cultural anthropology, and philosophy at the University of Vienna, and music, piano, composition at the Conservatory of the City of Vienna. Since 1984, she conducted extensive field work in South and Southeast Asia, Siberia, North Africa, Cuba, China, and Austria on medical pluralism, traditional healing and biomedicine, therapeutic dynamics of healing rituals, shamanism and spirit possession, as well as qualitative investigations of the sociocultural context of different medical systems, and communicative competence of traditional healers and biochemical doctors. She led numerous ethnopsychological and anthropological photo and video projects. She is the president of the Austrian Society for Medical Anthropology and member of the scientific board of the Theodor Körner Research Funds and of the medical board of the Austrian Federal Ministry for Defense and Sports. Now, Dagmar, please, we are waiting for your presentation.
Thank you. So at the beginning, I have to say I'm really afraid that I will shift now to much more profane and simple stuff than the two gentlemen before me. And in my previous life, I have been a neuro and sensory physiologist, but there came a time after my PhD thesis, I decided I just needed to more fresh air, and I set out to work on and about, but also mainly with traditional healers, many shamans, but as you will see, also with other kinds of traditional healers. But my background in sensory and neurophysiology was still good because traditional healing rituals or traditional rituals, they have a lot to do with sensory perception. And so what interested me is what it does then, this sensory perception with the multi-modalities to our consciousness and our health and our well-being. So in Nepal, there is a saying that there is no expert shaman who cannot sing and dance well. You know? So it's really part of the whole thing, and it is considered as very important. The study of shamanism has a long history, and I don't want to go into that, but what seemed to me important at first is that the shamans have often been described, I mean, in the earlier publications on shamans as the hysteric, the psychotic, the I don't know, whatever. There's hardly any diagnostic term that has not applied to the shamans. And I think this, the reason for this is very much connected with their really strong performances, you know, because this for the early European travelers who have documented what the shamans do, this seemed so strange that they thought they must be crazy, you know. And this notion, I mean, of course, in the scientific community doesn't exist anymore, but I must say there are some parts, and especially, you know, the biomedical doctors in my surroundings, I work at the medical university, it is still somehow there, you know. Yeah, we know we cannot diagnose it easily, but maybe there is something about it. And also the terms in which it was described in early publications, like ecstasy, or because it seemed somehow so strange. It was the foreign that could not be understood so well. And I think we are still struggling with understanding what they are doing. So, I mean, this is bringing all owls to Athens, if I show these pictures here, to just show that there has been quite considerable amount of literature and also illustrations from very early time on, like the 17th century. Like here from Schaeferus's famous book, Laponia, also 17th century. And here you already see that it has a lot to do with groups, with performance, with involving altered states of consciousness, and with groups. And today I also want to focus on group rituals and what is going on there and what can be the possible effects of healing or promotion of health and well-being. So this is a contemporary picture, and it's still really very colorful and so whatever. And I think for me, the epistemological basis seems very important. And I think that one of the difficulties in understanding what traditional healers or shamans in specific do is that since the age of enlightenment, rationality, you know, was too much central. And everything else, what was not rational and could not be incorporated in the, at that time, persistent theoretical frames, was somehow pushed aside, you know. And in the last decades, the study of consciousness, and this was the point where I set out in all of my doings, you know, took a new interest in traditional healing methods and also the study of shamanism. And it was then seen, you know, as something that we really have to look at more closely. And also in the study of consciousness or the neurosciences, since a few decades, it is very much a multidisciplinary endeavor or attempt, you know. So now every neurophysiologist or neuroscientist, you know, really looks at other fields as well, you know, ranging from anthropology to philosophy to psychology or psychotherapy or whatever. And to look at these things that at first for, I say, us Europeans, I mean, look so strange, so foreign, to look at them and try to understand them. Now, at least among the neuroscientists, you know, it seems really as a big chance to understand much more, and not only about the traditional healers or how it works, but of course also about ourselves, and also for designing new therapies for things. I mean, it's not like that Western biomedicine can treat everything so well, you know? So we really need more. So one central concept, of course, I mean, consciousness and altered states of consciousness. And what the shamans or also many other traditional healers do are very powerful techniques, now I just say techniques, to induce altered states of consciousness. So the benefits from that, you know, what we can borrow also from their techniques are also in neurology, you know, for example, as I said, new therapies, for example, age-related mental deficiencies, or development of new therapy techniques in general for prevention, what is now really has become a very big field, and of course for understanding human beings, understanding ourselves in a better way. The rhythmic stimulation, sometimes also called auditory driving, is a very prominent feature of shamanic performances, but as you will see also of performances of other kinds of traditional healers. And there have been some studies, some earlier studies also, for example, by Andrew Nehair in 1961, 1962, he published two studies. And he found that this rhythmic drumming of shamans in many cultures ranges from like 4 to 7 beats per second. And if we record the brain waves, which are, of course, some potentials from the surface of the brain, and then we see also a synchronization of brain waves in these 4 to 7 hertz, so beats per second. And this is a rhythm that is usually not present in the awake person. It's brain waves that we see more in the sleep. Interesting here that usually this is a tamang shaman in Kathmandu, and traditionally they played the drums only at night. I mean the big shamanic rituals, especially the healing rituals, they started after sunset and had to finish before sunrise. And if the whole thing was not finished, then it was continued in another night, but no drumming during sunshine. But this shaman is very much frequented. He sees about 40 to 60 patients each day, sometimes even up to 100. And so what he told me is that patients start coming in the early morning to his house and want to consult him and want to be treated. And he has to sleep sometimes. So he stopped doing the big night rituals where the usual shamanic drumming is employed. But for some cases, it is also necessary to use the drum. So he says, oh, well, it's just like this. What to do? I mean, he has so many clients that there is no time anymore to do the big elaborate rituals for each one. And I said, so, but if there is a case where it's really necessary to do like this full night ritual, and I said, yeah, then he transfers him to another shaman who has not so many clients, and he can do that with him. In Nepal is really abundant of traditional healers, and another kind of traditional healers are mediums of local deities, especially the female deities, the mother goddesses. And they also work in a similar way as the shamans, but they do not have drums, but they use the rhythmic singing and movements, and then usually they also have some jewelry that hanging, on their breast, and when they shake in the same rhythm as the shamans, sing and play the drum, this also starts to make the sound, and so it's the really very similar thing, but without drums, this rhythm. And so shamans and mediums, they create very similar multi-sense ritual performances. And always, in the beginning I said group rituals, and I think almost all rituals of shamans and of mediums are group rituals, because it's nothing, even a healing, even of some, I don't know, what we considered private thing, for example, sexual problem or potency problem, whatever, it's always talked about and dealt with in the group. So they're basically all group rituals. And this is not just only a side effect that the patients, take as it is, but actually it has really therapeutic effects also. And it seemed to me that patients really, liked it. And the only people who objected to that group sessions, were foreigners from Western countries. And these mediums in Nepal, but also in many other cultures, you know, they, even without drumming and without dancing, they do very spectacular performances. Like, this is one of the mediums which whom I have worked for a long time. She's on the outskirts, living on the outskirts of a village, I mean, of outskirts of Kathmandu. And this is a male medium. Most of the mediums are female. I mean, this has a lot of reasons. I don't want to go in right now. And this is a male medium, and he has especially dramatic performances. And of course, he is a medium of the same goddesses. I mean, it's Haratima and Dakshinkali, I mean, forms of Kali, you know. And they are the strong mother goddesses. They're also, you know, called on in many of the shamanic rituals because they have the power to deal with evil spirits or whatever, to deal with the causes of the illness. And so what is funny with a few male mediums, you know, they are often also addressed as Ma, Mother, Mata. The mediums, they merge with spiritual powers, with deities, in very much the same way as the shamans do in Nepal. And this spiritual component also has important functions, I say now. It enhances the feeling of care and the connectedness. And so, like, the group also plays an important part because it enhances even this feeling of being secure, being taken care of, and feeling connected. It's not only feeling connected with the healer and with the spiritual power, but with the whole group. And so one other. The videos together with this medium, you know, and she said, this is not me, no, this is not me, this is someone else, you know. But of course, she knows that it's her. But what she meant, yeah, now deity, you know, acting through her. And actually the mediums, I mean, it's not that they get possessed at one time and then deity leaves and then they are their normal selves anymore, but it's a growing, not only connectedness, but really becoming one with the spiritual power. And so this is also a question of lifestyle, you know, one to be so close to a deity, one has to live in a certain way, and so, but otherwise it would be impossible for the deity. So it's becoming one with the spiritual power. And they are one all the time, but sometimes more the aspects of the deity can be seen and heard, so this is our perception. And sometimes the everyday person, you know, can be more perceived, you know, seen and heard by us. And for me to understand this, of course, we have to look at the specific worldview, the concept of a person, and where are also the boundaries of a person, how reality is constructed and experienced. Then, of course, also concepts of illness causation, theories about the effects of treatments, the healing mechanisms, and also how different levels are connected at these rituals, but also more in the world view, you know, like the somatic, social, spiritual, the sensory, the visceral, and it's really a very strong connection, I mean, really becoming one. I mean, we are talking about psychosomatic diseases as if the psyche and the soma were two separate things, you know, and then apparently suddenly for some illnesses, they somehow act together, you know, but of course, they have all, but this is the age of enlightenment, you know, when the things that were not material were sort of cut off and more difficult to understand for a mechanistic, materialistic worldview. And so, And Vincent Capanzano has written in his book Tuhami, Portrait of a Moroccan, he says, the ethnographer's act of translating what is considered self-evident by the members of any particular cultural tradition may render bizarre, exotic, or downright irrational what would have been ordinary in its own context. So considering the worldviews, there's this classic atomistic worldview, and it says nature is a machine or like a machine that consists of many complicated but exchangeable parts. Objects are considered as being separate from nature and the spirits of nature. Persons are seen as separate from each other and as separate from nature, the surroundings. And it is a very materialistic worldview. And objects, it says that objects can be measured separately and exactly. And in what is still in our modern today science, you know, objects should be measured separately and exactly. But this is only due to this one kind of worldview. But there are others, for example, the systemic worldview. And Irvin Laszlo has, since more than 20 years, he's really been propagating that the classical atomistic worldview is somehow not fit for our sciences, for our time, for our understanding of things, and it should be replaced by the systemic worldview. There, nature or the cosmos is considered as an organism consisting of parts that are not exchangeable. There's the emphasis on the connection and communication between persons and between humans and nature and the supernatural world. And matter or material things are not seen as like the solid things anymore, but more the configuration of interacting energies. Now I go one step further. There's also the non-dual worldview. And it is, for example, in the traditional cultures, the traditions of Mahayana Buddhism, of Advaita Vedanta, the traditional philosophical system of the sub-Indian continent, and also in Taoism. So there are three cultures with an extensive written scientific literature that are based on the non-dual worldview. And that says there is no schism between subject and object. Like between you and me, there is no schism, we are one. You know, and this has really far-reaching consequences if you take it serious. Everything is one, everything is a unity. The humans are suspended in the cosmos, in the everything, in the one, in the unity. The I is not existent in the ontological sense. I mean, this we know from Mahayana Buddhism, like, for example, what we've heard in the first presentation. But I know that even, I know, I have many colleagues, and they are really been practicing meditation or mindfulness for a long time, but this, that the I doesn't really exist, this is still difficult. You know? And also, it doesn't make sense, you know, to compete, because we are all part of one, you know? So in competition, we are working against ourselves, against each other, against the whole thing. So that is not so good. Where could that lead to? And another thing, another term that I want to mention is culture. I mean, this is what the modern biomedical doctors usually do not want to hear, that every medical system comes out of a certain culture, is based on a certain culture, and is inevitably connected with that culture. No matter if we look at other geographic areas or if we go back in history, that has also been like our own history of medicine. I mean, that's different culture. And yet you have to look at the culture. And in the scientific community, since about 15 or 20 years, there's a big movement that culture, I mean, to take culture, not as just, you know, some side effect and some, I don't know, nice thing that we can put on things, but it is really the basis of everything. And so culture has regained the status of the basic condition of social order that permeates all domains of society. Relationships and family life, organizations of labor, ways of communication, meaning of language, body experience, science and epistemology, of course, also, and also medical systems, including modern biomedicine. So this is the part that's most difficult for me working at the Medical University of Vienna. One term that has been coined by Hannertz is culture is everywhere. You know, health systems, ideas about health and disease, concepts about illness causation, healing methods, concepts of the human body, of the human, like if you have the body and the mind, or holistic views, principles of cause and effect in respect to natural as well as spiritual realms, views about persons who are deviant from the norm and how we should deal with them. Of course, this is all influenced by culture. So, medical systems have been developed in certain cultures and in specific periods of time. They represent worldviews, concepts of persons and forms of societies. They are the basis for illness categories, expression of suffering, which is also important, and therapy methods. Concepts of illness causation and diagnostic systems are, of course, culture dependent. And therefore, the diagnosis of different medical systems are never identically and can never be translated one to one, you know, like from one system to another system. And one example is the diagnosis of being bewitched. And of course, also in Nepal, it's not equal to the depressive syndrome in Western biomedicine. And Annette Wiemann-Michels has written very nice medical thesis, and where she just investigates that and brings all kinds of examples. And of course, she comes to the conclusion this being bewitched is not the same as the depressive syndrome, even though in many symptoms it looks so similar. but it is not the same. And I must say, like in some of my presentations and when I have talked about also case studies or shown videos of that, and there was also always the question, so what illness does the patient suffer from? What's really wrong with him? And I said, well, I don't know. We all don't know, you know? I mean, you can listen to the patient, you know, what symptoms he is complaining about. You can listen to the healer, what diagnosis he does. But the diagnosis is not so much as, you know, sort of summing up the patient's problems and then say, well, this is it, like telling the reality. But the diagnosis of traditional healers is more there for, you know, the path to go on, what has to happen. And like these big night rituals where also then at least important family members have to be present, and it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of preparation. It also takes, you know, money to get the materials and stuff. And so, like, for example, if the patient is a woman, and sometimes the husband, and especially if they think they are so modern, and then they have some resistance, you know, to take part in this whole thing and provide everything that is needed to be present there himself, you know, and to cooperate. But as soon as there is this diagnosis, and in Nepal, it's, for example, especially the diagnosis, a witch has sent an evil-causing spirit to harm a person, you know, then there is no way out. And everyone knows that in the communities, and the husbands have no chance but to go along, you know. And this is the importance of the diagnosis, you know, to make the way for the treatment that the healer thinks is necessary. And I mean, how the healers do the diagnosis is really a very big subject on its own. And it's, of course, it starts as it's a starting point for the rituals designed to solve the problems and alleviate the suffering. And of course, the individual problems are interpreted in the framework of traditional patterns. You know? And for example, in one case, when I was like, so what is, and I also asked, yeah, what is wrong with the patient? And I mean, of course, I didn't want to hear the diagnosis, but the symptoms, you know. And I said, yeah, the patient is just not well, and sometimes the soles of her foot burn a little, you know. But the healer, it was a really big healing ritual, you know. And the healer says, this is a life-threatening condition, you know. If this healing ritual is not performed, the patient will certainly die, you know. Just imagine to go to a doctor and you think really your life cannot continue anymore. And when a doctor asks about the patient, say, well, I'm not well, you know. Sometimes the soles of my foot are burning a little bit. And Wolfgang Pfeiffer, who is the founder of transcultural psychiatry, he has written, you know, the terrible thing about the diagnosis like schizophrenia is that it neither provides comprehensible hints how the illness has come about or how it can be combated, but instead it stigmatizes the patient and the family in public opinion. And then he goes on, you know, in this is very nice paper, what makes a conversation or what makes it therapeutic, you know? And he continues that, for example, being bewitched, there it's completely different because it gives, you know, reasons for the whole problem that can be easily understood by the whole community. That, uh-huh, yeah, because of, no, we're doing that. It provides, you know, something, a kind of treatment that has to be done and that will then lead to a good end. There are just only a few exceptions, but normally it heals. You know? And the patients are, I mean, at least in indigenous cultures, the patients and family are not stigmatized. You know, it's illness it can come about, you know. Now, I mean, in my culture and in Austria, in my country, I mean, if you say it is bewitched, or whatever, I mean, I don't know, crazy. We have lost these kind of language, you know. I would almost call it symbolic language, but through which we can understand in a better way. I mean, if you use like some diagnostic manual, I mean, how to communicate, you know, the doctor, patient, I mean, they can't even understand each other anymore. And this has a lot to do with the world way, with the world view, with the social life, with the society. And one thing that Carstairs wrote already in 1958, you know, he said, everyone, this is about also spirit possession in India. It says, everyone sees it happen to others and expects without question that in similar circumstances it will happen to oneself. And it does. But no need, you know, to be upset, because there are ways to deal with that. Now I'll turn to the examples of the group rituals. And they're often really quite big, and they're especially these group rituals, but which are most rituals, you know, and they're this multi-sense with different sensory modalities especially pronounced, you know. This is one community ritual of the Vajrayana Buddhists in Nepal. And I want to speak another term, communitas, which has been turned by Victor Turner. And he's communitas, he understands, in this sort of central phase of the ritual, the liminal phase, the social structure changes. You know, this is a state of equality without the social hierarchy that is there in everyday life. And this creates special conditions that are different to those in everyday life, and he calls it the anti-structure. I mean, that the structure of everyday life, of the society in everyday life, is not alleviated. It means it's not completely unstructured, but he calls it the anti-structure. It's just really different. And in this liminal phase, in this state of communitas, you know, people are especially susceptible to change, to the healing change also. And this feeling of communitas is expressed in several ways. Like, I don't think you can see it so well here, but at this community ritual, they're all sitting in a circle, and they're connected by a thread that each person holds it in the hands. You know? This is a ritual of the Newars in Nepal, who are said to be especially complicated and traditional, and it's so difficult to get along with them and to get inside information, which is, I don't know, I didn't find that at all, you know. I was with them. And also for this, like being connected with each other by this thread, you know, everyone is invited. The beggars, me as a foreigner, you know. So it's this creation of these communitas. And at these group rituals, there are just many things happening, you know. Like in this picture, you see one medium who is spontaneously, you know, giving a nice performance. When I mean performance, I don't mean it as a not authentic thing, but it's just this, what we can perceive with our different sense organs. So it's seeing on one side, it's hearing, it's smelling, for example, the smoke here. It's also the touch skin sensibility, also, for example, holding the thread in your hand. So this is another example of the two mediums, up and down, so different actions that take place. This was a very big ritual. It lasted for several days. And so there was some new ornaments for the temple there of Chandeshwari. And so all the people carry it around. So everyone takes part there. And lower, there is a tantric priest who is also helping with that, working there. And at one stage of the ritual, he's just throwing the flower petals over everyone. He goes around in the circle and some holy water, spreading it. So again, the skin sensibility. And there are always music group at those big rituals. So in between the music group plays and some people, whoever feels like it, starts dancing or singing or whatever. And the common meal, you know, the cooking is done on site. So there's again this smell that is in the air. Then when you're eating, it's the taste. So really all sensory organs are employed by that, you know. And I mean, this cooking, it's also done, whoever feels like it takes part in the cooking. I must say, I've never seen such big pots in my life. And then there is the common meal, and there also everyone is invited. Beggars, tourists who just happen to pass by, everyone. Yeah. And this is a very important part, and it somehow is really also bringing this feeling of the togetherness very much. Like, even though I come from a very different culture, but to take part in them, in that, I mean, I'm one of them, and they accepted me one of them in those difficult Nivaris. And at the last part, the healers or ritual specialists who were sort of conducting the whole event, they give the blessing, and also in the way of something, I don't know, flowers, ashes, water, whatever. And there was a long queue, there were several hundred people, you know, and even the most crooked businessman, he doesn't want to miss that, he wants to get the blessings. And everyone is equal, you know, the big shot or the Lord Mayor, he does not come first, you know, he has to stand in line also. So these community rituals, they are for health promotion, for prevention, for stress reduction, strengthening of relationships within a group and between groups. I think we could do it with refugees or migrants, these group rituals, doing something together, which has a big effect, you know. It's improving cultural identity, you know, but it doesn't mean that everyone has to have one cultural identity or the same, I mean, but to know who I am, who am I, what is my identity? And of course also for reducing post-traumatic stress disorders and also alleviating somatic symptoms. The therapeutic effects of the ritual performance are, I mean, just to name just a few possibilities, the rhythmic stimulation, we've talked about it, and it also gives a feeling of structure to the participants. I mean, the personal, I don't mean the social structure, but personal structure. The ritual enhances the release of endorphins and enkephalins. There's one paper by Fretschka and Kulcher, older paper. Mobilization of support, feeling of security, improvement, the mood, so, and many more, of course. And Robert Desjarlais, I don't know how to pronounce him, and in one of his books, Body and Emotion, and he connects now this multi-sense experience in the rituals, with the body, with the visceral side, you know, it's not only the psychological effect, and he says this has the potential to wake up a person and alter the sensory grounds of a spiritless body, and he connected that very much with depressive symptoms, not depression as an illness, and changes, and like this changes how a person feels. And he's worked with the Yolno in Nepal, and he has written that Spirit Calling is an imagistic poem invoking a change of sensibility in the bodies of the participants a change that is in the lasting mood or disposition that contribute to the sensory grounds of a person's existence. It is the poem's or the performance's visceral impact rather than the metaphoric structure that affects the change. So this is quite different from some other anthropologists who will say it's the symbolic structure and the symbolic meaning, but he says it's much more deep also as well to them. And of course there's the symbolism and everything also. And the impact ties into the senses, healing of bodies, of sensibilities, of ways being in the world takes place. If the ritual is to be considered successful, it must change how a person feels. So the emphasis is on the performative and dramaturgical aspects of the ritual healing, the presence of the senses, the multi-sense experiences, and the extent to which performances can change how a person feels. Now, one example of a shamanic ritual, and this is a healing ritual for one person, but of course it was also a group ritual because there were many people present. And the shaman tries to sort of synchronize with the patient or through the sensory bombardment somehow draws her into the whole story of the ritual performance of like what happened, what has to be done, but which is then really on a I don't want to say metaphorical, it's true also. So this is the way to get rid of an illness-causing spirit, to give him a substitute, to give him something to eat. And by this, not only the patient, but all the participants get into resonance with this sensory stimulation. And so this state of resonance can also contribute to break down maladaptive behavior patterns, and that new, more adaptive and healthier patterns can be arised and reinforced. And this, I mean, the videos are of course very short now, but this is a quite long process, and those are added up, and it has such a power that it draws everyone into it. So traditionally, people would attend these kind of rituals even if they have nothing to do, neither with the patient or the family, the patient's family, or with the healer or that family, but just to attend it and by that also experience some healing, even though at that time there's not such a big problem that he would go and seek a healer. The introduction of television in Nepal has changed all this. And I mean, this multi-sense experiences, you know, like involving all the different sensory modalities. It is the question, is it just to make it stronger, the effect and the resonance? Or some say that it is, then there is something there for everyone, because some people respond more to the visual, some more to the auditory, or some more to the olfactory. It may be both. You know? And so the patient now is really...
I'm here, 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 I'm
So they are now very much synchronized, and the patient speaks in the same rhythm of, you know, single words as the shaman before did it also. And it is very much a bodily experience, because if you take part in that for some hours, there's really some change. So I think I'm quite, it's getting late. I want to bring some other examples now of group rituals, like one from Inner Mongolia. I mean, there is really a lot of revitalization of shamanism taking place. And they are also performances with much emphasis on the aesthetic qualities, on the perception qualities. Shamans there, they showed me certificates they got by the government, you know, how good they are, you know, the shaman's certificate. But the shamans also, they are not just performers, but they also work as healers. And now they can do it, and I asked, so do they have any problem with the government? And they said, No, as long as they don't do any mischief, as long as no one dies, it's okay. And they are really sought after. They're very much frequented. But they still, even though they are allowed to do it, but they don't do it so openly. I mean, you have to know it and ask for it. So it's also a shamanic performance in Inner Mongolia, which is very colorful there, very rhythmic. Another example from China is in Qinghai, the Wutu means tiger ritual. It's a ritual to drive out winter, and in Europe we have this tradition also, which is also revitalized now, but not like that, you know. So it is driving out winter, and with that illnesses that are there, especially in winter, hunger, I mean the scarcity of food, or bad luck, or everything, you know. And you must keep in mind that this area in Qinghai Tongren, is the altitude is about 2,500 meters, and the outside temperature is about minus 20 degrees. They have to take off all their clothes, except one little pants that they have to roll up also. And then in the night before, seven young men are selected, and then they have to go through certain tests, you know, to see if they are really apt for that. But of course, they always pass the test. But this is also entertainment for the, not only for the whole community, but even outsiders. There were some Chinese tourists from the cities, and me. And in that area, they also have a very strong tradition of tanka painting, you know. And it's also the UNESCO World Heritage of tanka painting there. And so the ritual specialists with helpers, you know, they are painted there as tigers and also as leopards, you know. And then for entertainment of everyone, then some of the Chinese tourists, and I myself also, they can have photos taken of themselves with them, you know, and there's really this joking atmosphere. And I think the humor is really also plays a big role in that. And then these seven men, you know, and in front the ritual specialists that dance through the village, they're receiving offerings from the people, and of course they take all the bad unwanted things with them. And this also lasts for a long time. So in Austria, as I said, we also had this winter driving out stuff. And so on the left side, you see Austria, Perchten, as we say. And there's also a big revitalization movement now. But I think people are not so concerned about the meaning of it all, because this running the Pärchen, it becomes earlier and earlier. Traditionally, it should be between Christmas and the Holy Kings on the 6th of January. But now they are beginning of November, December, end of November, beginning of November, you know. But it's to drive out the winter, so at least it should be the height of the winter, if not a little later, you know. But and then how does it really feel if it's not the winter that is experienced by the people, and if the winter has not been there long enough that the people get really sick and tired of it, you know. So it is a tourist attraction, but I think that would not matter, because in Qinghai there were also the Chinese tourists. But if it is like shifted to the seasonal returnals, if they're shifted to a different season and no one knows anymore what they are really for, I don't know, it's questionable, it still works. So one more pictures, left side, Pärchen running through the village in Austria, and right, tigers and leopards running through the village in Qinghai. There are other winter rituals, so driving out winter rituals in Austria. This was from this year in January. It's called Schellerlauf. Schellen means to refers to these big bells, and Lauf means to run. So they also go through the village, and they make this jumping, and it's really a big thing. And when I was there, I had a chance to talk with the Lord Mayor before this main thing, and they said, yes, they are also now enlisted in this UNESCO safeguarding of intangible cultural heritage. And now they feel really the responsibility to preserve it, to safeguard it, and let it stay the same as it always has been, question mark, or I think he meant as it is now. But the thing is, every traditional ritual, you know, is changing. It never stays the same. It is never frozen to one point of time, you know. And in this case, in the Schellerlauf in the Tyrol, this is what the Lord Mayor told me, that all figures, even the female figures, like here you see the witches, you know, can only be incorporated or played by men. So the women are the obedient. They have to sew the costumes for the men, they have to prepare the meal, and the men, I mean, it's really for several weeks, this preparation's gone, and the practice and everything, and I think that they spend many nights in the village inn and drinking and talking together. And the women, you know, they're pushed in the house and helping the men, like sewing their dresses and then preparing everything for them. So if the Lord Mayor says they have to preserve it as it is now, what if the women then come and say, we don't want it like this anymore? The Tyrol, this area, is very conservative, you know? But what, like, if in 10 years or 20 years or maybe even in 2 years, you know, they come and say, no, we also want to take part actively in that way and not only serve our husbands, you know? So what about the safeguarding of intentional cultural heritage? And I think this is one problem in this whole program that is worldwide, the intangible cultural heritage, you know? At least what I know from Austria, that it's not really thought about. What is tradition? What does it mean? How does it have to be preserved? Or what is with the natural development? You know, like the traditional healers in Assam, in Nepal, they're really very good. If something in the society changes, they adapt without question. I mean, they don't even talk about it. So with this cultural heritage, I mean, do we not allow it to take its just normal course of development? And now that we think more about culture and how important it is, there's also this modern concept of culture, and that it's not anymore this specified, stable, frozen, enclosed entity that has to stay the same all the time, but it is seen culture as a changing open system in process. So now we think of culture as complex, dynamic, and hybrid. So just as a summary, advantage of traditional healing rituals, I mean, positive things, they're cheap, I mean, economical, most of them. They're family and community oriented, integrative, they have somatic, social, and psychological effects. It's a socially accepted way to cope with problems and acting out, like the catharsis is sometimes also quite spectacular, without losing self-esteem or appreciation in the group. At that, on those days or during the rituals, they can do whatever they want. And they also use the opportunities. There are possibilities to renew the effects frequently. I mean, I think the effects wear out, you know, but there is a certain, it's a repetitive thing, and so you can renew the effects. And it's a great way for personal growth and development with long-lasting effect, but also on the somatic, on the visceral side. It's not only psychological, what sometimes people say. So, thank you.